Hi, I'm Mariah Inger.
And I'm Warona Setshwaelo.
And we are the coordinators of the Artist Mentorship Program, lovingly known as AMP, from Black Theatre Workshop.
We would like to start by dedicating the presentation you are about to see to the land that has been stolen and remains stolen. The art that we make here at the Artist Mentorship Program is in an effort to dismantle oppressive systems and return the land back to its original inhabitants. The original caretakers of this land are and continue to be the Ghanaian Gahaka, the Abenaki, the Anishinaabe, and the Huron-Wendat people. We stand with you. Aluta continua.
Thank you for that. So welcome. This is the Industry Showcase Season 2021 from AMP. We're very excited. It's the first time we are doing a full completed live streaming. Today you will see excerpts from a play titled Libation, written by our industry playwright this year, our mentee, Esi Callender. You will also see a scene from a play titled The Motherfucker in the Hat by Stephen Adley Gerges, and a multitude of different monologues written by different playwrights throughout the show today.
And a couple of songs.
We'd
also like to thank our sponsors and the people that supported us to make this happen. And that would be Canadian Heritage, the City of Montreal, the Dan School of Music and Drama, Geordie Theatre, and TD Canada.
We are so happy you have come to join us today. We are very excited. I know our mentees are extremely excited to present a show to you today. So thank you for taking out the time. After the show, we will be having a talk back. So there'll be plenty of time to ask some questions in our Facebook or our YouTube pages. So please stay tuned after that. Thank you so much. We appreciate it. Welcome to the show.
Bon spectacle.
Hi, I'm Esi Callender, and I wrote Libation, from which you're about to see some excerpts. Importantly, Libation is a play for an all-black cast. So for the synopsis, it begins in Act 1, where we meet Allie, a white girl and aspiring author who moves into a freshly gentrified neighborhood in a nameless North American city. Immediately inspired, she writes a novel telling the story of a black woman who lived there before her. The novel is published, and Allie is ascending. That is, until she meets Desdemona, a black woman who is losing her memory but swears that Ali has stolen her story, and the encounter between them destroys them both. Then, in Act 2, we meet Desi, a black PhD dropout, now barista, who is drunk in their bathtub after sending their newest play to an unresponsive mailing list. Mona arrives, demanding an explanation for the desperate script. "I get why you killed the white girl, but why did you kill yourself?" asks Mona, a black Ghanaian immigrant who came to get a degree, a Western passport, and the fuck out. The two rehash the commitment that their friendship requires, failed revenge plots and perfected essays, twists of adulthood, and visions for the future. Enjoy.
Daddy's hands. You he up and left me. I dressed up and ran. Only thing in my head. You were your daddy's son. Couldn't hear no music. She was frightened, crazy from the fright. Tears without no comfort, screams without no sound. Only darkness and pain, the anger and pain, the blood and the pain. I buried my heart in the ground. Wants no excuses. I have only one. You had your daddy's hands. Forgive me. You were your dad.
I was gonna say a piece of shit. Possibly haunted. But you and your silver linings are so adorable.
I'm tired, Steven. I'm tired of saying that I'm sorry all the time. I am tired of tiptoeing through my life because it might interfere with yours. I am tired of being told what opera to like, what movie to go to, what book to read. I am tired of being your father, your mother, your big brother, your best friend, your analyst, your cheerleader. I haven't been your lover since the first night I said to myself, Who is this person, this stranger lying at my side? Who hasn't heard me or held me since the last time it pleased him? That was the night that I should have grabbed you by the shoulders and screamed that I don't want this, Stephen. I don't need just another warm body by my side. I am much too needy to settle for so little. Look at me. Love me. Be with me. Now I waited too long. You weren't even sleeping. You were reading. You had your friend on your cassette player on your side of the bed. Maria Callas. I had my arm around you. I was stroking one of your tits. And I asked you how you thought I should handle Sarah. She was coming up to New York and wanted to see me. It was the first time since the divorce, and I was scared. I'd hurt her in a way that I was ashamed of, and I really needed you, Stephen. And you just shrugged, and you said, you'll do the right thing. And you turned the page. I didn't stop stroking your tit. But you weren't the same person anymore. And neither was I. I kept my arm around you only because I was suddenly so scared that I was as alone as I must have made Sarah feel. I was holding on for dear life.
We are all big fakes. Fake it till we make it, that's what we do. And that's what the universe does. Gives us what we want, even though we're only pretending to be ready. Give me that night. In a van. In a parking lot. That perfect night under the stars. The way the first time's supposed to be. Feeling like something besides myself. Terrified. Excited. Lost and confused. Looking. Those brown Italian eyes. Finding comfort in knowing what I want. That this is what I want. Takes me over like natural urges. Fake my way right into it. Calm, straighten the eyes. Brave enough, strong enough. Ready, unafraid, willing and wanting. Fake prepared. Fake like I know what happens next. Fake like it's been done a million times before, and now it's no big deal. It's nothing at all. We both know we weren't supposed to, but we both feel it. Intensity, unspoken energy, and for a moment we both become fire. A spark, both burning and growing. Knowing while forgetting that this won't last forever. Nothing this intense could last forever. The world would just explode. But for a moment, it was ours. We didn't talk about it. Couldn't. There's no room in that van for talk. There's no room in that star-filled sky for empty words and reasons. Before he started the ignition to drive us both back to that small town in an even smaller world, he turns to me. He looks at me. He looks straight at me with those brown Italian eyes. He asked me with his calm, beautiful, confident, and completely fake smile. Did it hurt? And I didn't know what else to say except, isn't it supposed to?
So, this book?
Yes.
What's it about?
Well, it's about a young woman living in the city, sort of on a journey of self. No. So she's living away from her home country for the first time.
Don't mention you're living with an ethnic girl.
Uh-huh.
Have you gotten her permission to use her story?
No.
It counts. Even if she was under the influence and gave you some sort of narrative, okay?
No, it's not about me.
Is it a genre novel?
It's a literary novel.
So you've got your young woman,
uh-huh.
Your city, you're coming of age.
And, yes, and you know it's this city. It's my neighborhood, even. And it's historical. Sort of. She's this very self-possessed young woman. Very critical and yet very loving. And it's about how she navigated institutions and love and just trying to keep a roof over her head through these moments of profound change for the Black community.
Ali.
I know. I am a white woman writing about a Black woman's story.
Your word.
Oh God, Georgia. I thought about if it's, you know, problematic. I really think if you just read it, I really think I'm doing her justice. It doesn't speak for all Black women, just this one I could not get out of my head.
But people can be so sensitive these days about representation.
Right? Like they need more positive representation of complex Black characters.
But Ali, you would have to answer this question time and time again. Why are you the right person to write this novel?
Maybe I'm wrong. But I'm an artist. This is what I'm trained to do. This is what I have to offer the world. I don't want to spend my entire life navel-gazing, always centering my own perspective and being afraid of... I'm an artist. Aren't I supposed to tell stories, important ones? I mean, who else is going to?
We're going to read it. But I warn you. Lady Parts Press is a very liberal publishing house, mostly women, many feminists. But we are looking for coming of age and inspiring. And you know, this could be some sort of essential read to understand a young female's perspective amidst a civil rights movement taking over our streets.
Wow! And I could work with a Black editor and a Black book designer and...
Yes, oh yes, we would try, but there isn't always the interest, unfortunately. But... If it doesn't pass the sniff test for us, but I find it a good read, I can always pass it to my brothers-in-law's press, the Devil's Advocate Publishing. Now, you've heard of them? They still do blackface. So they can do a more sensationalist marketing strategy, trumping the edginess of it all.
And what if they don't want it?
Oh, you're a bright young woman. You shouldn't worry. Someone will want it. And Linda, your mother, has other contacts. How about I don't mention too much about the woman behind the book just for our first reads, then we'll get a sense of how my colleagues feels about it on its own. And if absolutely necessary, you can always become Black.
Pardon?
Only for as long as it's convenient. You can borrow someone's last name or use a pseudonym. Or have a great, great granddaddy for a time.
I guess I've heard of that.
Oh, I always advise young writers to give themselves a little bit of a wiggle room.
Are you
racially ambiguous?
Oh, yes.
Tragically.
You have no idea how proud of you we are.
We stand you no matter what.
Do we stand?
Yes, we stand.
Do we stand?
Yes, we stand.
I literally feel like it's all about to come crashing down on me.
Out with it.
We're here for you, sweetie. Georgia called saying that her assistant's been archiving all their manuscript submissions from the last like 10 years of open calls. And there's one of these random ass manuscripts that she said sounded eerily similar to my book!
What do you mean, like someone plagiarized you?
Or like, I think they think I plagiarized!
Oh my God, baby, no, that's important.
Seriously, Francis? How could you even ask me that right now? Of course not!
We know you didn't, baby.
I'm so fucking scared right now!
What can we do?
I don't know!
to do. Like, how many copies of this fucking manuscript is out there? Who is this fucking person?
That's a good question. Who are they?
Georgia gave me her name. Desdemona?
Is that a joke?
Maybe it's a pen name.
For a tragic mulatto?
I don't think you should, like, say that word.
It's the actual literary term for that trope. Are you, like, offended?
I don't think you meant anything by it, Francis.
Guys!
Focus!
Yeah, he's my brother. But we ain't close. Ain't like we grew up together or nothing. Ain't like I'm going around his house every Christmas singing Silent Night. Shit, I didn't even know the fucker existed till I was like 14. I'm coming out of school one day, right? And I see this immigrant kid waiting there. He's looking at me, see? But I don't think nothing of it. People are often looking at me, you know? I got striking features or something. Anyway, after that, everywhere I go, I see him, man. This immigrant kid. He's like my fucking shadow. He's like my little immigrant shadow. I walk, he walks. I stop, he stops. Eventually I just stop and fucking stare at him. See, like this, and I'm like, okay, shorty, spill. He's got this posh little voice, man, and he's like, I know you. You're Nigel, aren't you? I'm like, yeah, I know who the fuck I am. Who the fuck are you? He's like, my name's Karim. I think we might be related. I'm like, yeah? He's like, yeah, I think you're my brother, Nigel. I'm like, go away, kid. I ain't got no brother. But he just stands there, right? This sweet little kid. And then he go, listen to this, then he go, neither do I, but I think you might be him. Neither do I, but I think you might be him. He must have heard his uncles talking, see? Laughing about his old man going on and on about Papa's little white boy. That's what they call him, Papa. Like he's the big daddy or something. Like he's got baby mamas all around shop. Like he's some kind of Mac. He's a smart kid. Anyway, I'm like, fuck off, kid. I ain't your brother. I ain't no immigrant, am I? But then I tell my mother, and I know from her face, man, I know from her silence, I know from those little tart eyes, that kid telling the truth. It's like when I was little, and I'd be going to school, and people would be shouting, immigrant, 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 hey, immigrant, immigrant, and I'm looking around, but I don't see no immigrant. They're shouting at me, see? And I'm like, I'm fucking Canadian, man, I ain't no immigrant. But they was right. They was right. They knew me better than I knew myself. Immigrant. Nigel the immigrant.
I don't give a fuck about your fight. Fuck your progress. This is your progress, nigga. Me. Here, I'm your fucking progress. This is what you achieved. Shit. Deal with that, nigga. Deal with the sacrificial fucking lamb to your better world. And what is better, huh? What the fuck did you achieve? My mama died with a broken heart waiting on your progress. You were the motherfucker who wouldn't throw her a damn bone. You want these letters so bad? Why'd you never write her? I'm not talking about them scrap pages of your ideas and meditations when you were locked up and getting your brain swollen with information on politics and philosophies and whatever. I'm not talking about that intellectual masturbation on a fucking piece of prison paper. I'm talking reciprocity. I'm talking speaking from the core of your goddamn heart instead of sounding like a fucking activist robot. I know her better than you ever will. I listen to her pine over your worthless ass. I listen to her talk about what she thought made you such a goddamn hero. How you stood up for niggas getting railroaded by the justice system. How you stood up for anybody being brutalized by the cops. How you protested corporations helping to fund apartheid. How you did all this shit for the whole goddamn free world. But when she told you she loved you, what'd you do, huh? When she told you she wanted you to settle the fuck down and be with her, what'd you do, huh? You stand up for that shit?
Ugh, maybe my book's about nothing if it's never been read.
No one's ever read it?
Well, my friends have. have good friends too who will read you and tell you what they really think about you and mark up your pages and talk about you like you put something to the world, even though it's only held together by strings.
A mess of pages.
Yeah, it didn't look professional, but after all the notes, I wrote up a second draft and it didn't look half bad. It read well. I sent it round to a few places, but I figured to get a book published in this country, especially as a black girl, you have to at least know someone who knows someone.
Then why would they have open calls?
To keep the myth of meritocracy alive. To justify capitalism?
Oh! You know, I also struggle with the question of what is your work about? Because I really think about why I'm right, which is really to connect to people, especially women, across our differences.
What do you mean by that?
What?
Like what differences?
Like, for instance, telling more stories of marginalized women so that others can understand them.
They can't tell their own stories?
I think it's the responsibility of artists to tell all stories that are vitally needed in our society.
That sounds real nice. Yeah, maybe I'm just paranoid after all these years, but I'm always a bit on edge when someone gets their rhetoric to sound so perfect like that.
I'm far from perfect. Desdemona, I have something for you. Oh, what are you doing?
Don't judge a book by its cover, right? I want to see what you got here. Oh my god!
What do you think?
Where did you get this?
I got a book deal with Lady Parts.
I thought they never read it!
I'm sorry?
What, who the hell are you?
Excuse me!
No, 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 I don't mean to be rude. I mean, what kind of god sent you?
Oh, you're sweet.
How the hell is this happening? This isn't a joke, is it?
I'm sorry, I don't think
somebody
I understand.
Somebody printed my book?
No, those are... This is my book.
See, that's not possible! These are my words! I wrote these words by hand and then retyped them day by day, sit before work, after church, sitting in the... after fucking sitting in the chair by the window until it was finished.
That's nothing!
No,
I think you're confused.
I wrote these words. I still have them in my... You want to see? There's a difference between painting a back fence and writing a poem, but only one of quantity. And there is, for me, no difference between writing a poem and moving into sunlight against the body of a woman I love.
What the fuck?
Look! Every word matches, can I?
Ah, get away from me!
No, I'm just trying to show you that these are all the same words. These are my words. This is my life in words and question marks.
This book is my whole life right now. You're not gonna take that away from me. I worked way too hard.
How can it be your whole life when it's got my whole life in it?
Let me show you.
This is the only copy I've got. I can't fight you!
Please, don't hurt me!
I can't! You know! Every time someone like you moves into a neighborhood like this, you are sentencing someone else to an unthinkable fate. But not even your kind will forgive what you're doing right now.
What else can I do?
Thank you.
sick. I prayed. I really prayed, Michael. I told him. I told God. Bring her out of this, please. I'll do anything. Anything. And when she died, I thought, fine. You're just going to have to do it yourself. I left the seminary because I needed to learn how to help people, really help people, heal people, cheat death. When I saw my first bird, I'd studied, I'd seen the film, but when I saw life come into being, into the room, when I cut the miraculous fruit of life with my own two hands, I knew that's what I wanted to do, to bring life, to bring as many life into the world and catch as many new souls. That is cheating death. It doesn't make sense, but that's what I thought. Meningitis. If I couldn't catch meningitis in my only child, to save her, to save me. You know how much I wanted babies, our babies. And we kept losing. I kept losing. And then Janie, she stayed. She grew. She would hold me so tight around my waist sometime. Like, she was trying to get back inside of me. Like, I was her fingers and toes, and she'd miss having them around all day. Like, I was her everything. And she was mine. And I'm still there, Michael. I'm always there. She's on the toilet. I'm on my knees holding her hands, and then she falls on my breast. And I think she's playing. She must be playing, but she won't wake up, Michael. And she's in my arm. And I'm calling 911, and I am trying to get her back, and then it stops. Her heart stops. Everything stops. And I get it started again, and it's okay. It's all right. She's gonna be okay. And I'm running. I started running because it comes to me. If I run fast enough, faster than time, time will slow down and go backward. I can't run fast enough, Michael. I can't run fast enough.
Black debt. In fact, you only speak through to the white girl's rambling guilty conscience, and then you write her this metaphysical esoteric debt.
That's my artistic license.
Yeah, is it also your cry for help?
Oh no, is that why you're here? That's why you left the party? I thought you came here to toast me and say stellar play, Desi. Congratulations. You really knocked my socks off.
I am on that. Oh, that is not, that is Shelly. Not something I would come here to say. You were supposed to meet me there, and then you were not answering my text.
Oh, I'm so sorry. I don't mean to make you worry about me. I never want to make you feel that way.
Well then, don't take drunken and whatever else bubble baths like your Whitney Houston.
May she rest in power, huh? You watched the documentary I sent you.
I told you I will engage with the North American minutia you sent me on the condition that it is about black culture. It is the only thing worth reclaiming from this continent.
That's... A lot of people would find that very offensive, Mona. There's like other thriving arts here. And you're kind of throwing the indigenous culture babies out with the colonial.
Hey, for me, I can go. I am here for you.
No, don't go. You should stay. We deserve a small day.
I will stay. I will have a drink in here, even. On the condition that you get one of your pillows to make that toilet a proper seat. Abraham and Isaac before my very eyes.
One
ancestors.
And for the homies. Look, Desi, you are doing it again.
What?
This time in the form of plays.
Theater is the worst medium, I know.
It is better than your performance art phase.
Do you remember that time when I dressed up in a nude bodysuit, but not like me nude, like white person nude? And then I just tried to crack open this entire watermelon with my bare hands, and then ate it in its entirety, even the shell, with my bare mouth. And how did that get into such a serious gallery?
Desi, you are making people deal with your emotions. With your constipated emotions.
I think the word you're looking for is repressed.
Emotions are so guttural, see? You are making me deal with it with each new fever dream play that you send me. It is the same reason why I told you we cannot be friends if you kept serving all these white people.
And I heard you because you were so right. Mm-hmm. And I broke up with Madison and moved out of that toxic queer cooperative living space, and I even set boundaries with my mom, man. With my mom.
Yeah, you have made a lot of progress, and I am proud of you. But you know, I cannot take any responsibility for that, right? That is all, those were your choices.
Yo, yes, I know. It's just, you're such a real friend. You tell shit to me straight up, fucking hold me to account. I love that. Mm. I hope I do that for you.
You do. You have a certain... you have been a very loyal and committed friend. But when we get to these points when you are putting so much energy into white people, whether it is taking care of them, or navigating their spaces, or writing plays.
The plays are an outlet.
When you are doing all that, what do you have left for your black community? Desi, what do you have left for me? What do you have left for you?
Community is a tricky topic. Coercive, even.
I know, we can get back to that. But do you understand what I mean?
Yes, I understand. But what can you do? They're everywhere.
Well, I am going back to Africa.
Mona.
What? I can say that. It is literally where I'm from. I'm going back. No. I lived in Accra up until just 5 years ago.
I mean, Mona, I'm gonna miss you.
Well, then maybe you should become the kind of friend who can run away with me. Or who can go on more adventures and find more true friends so you'll not be so heartsick missing me.
Maybe. But man cannot change his nature.
Well, good thing you are something much stranger than a man. No, but I did appreciate your little shout out to me in the play. Comparative literature. When I got the letter of rejection claiming that I could not be admitted despite my qualifications because there was no one in the department familiar with any West African languages to supervise me.
A self-fulfilling prophecy.
That was the worst night of my life. But you did not let me be alone. This country started to feel inescapable again. I thought I would drown in her shallow pool of mediocrity and immigrants' tears.
And white kids' piss.
Yeah, that was the worst night of my life. But you did not let me be alone.
Count on me, your local college dropout, to talk shit about academia with you anytime.
You made me eat, and you made sure I did not lose my mind for good.
Hey, I can't take all the credit for that. You've made a lot of progress.
Well, take some credit, because that is why I'm here, to answer your cry for help.
Boy, you sure do like reciprocity, huh? Mm-hmm. So, can I go down on you?
No.
I was just joking.
I know, just to be clear.
You know, it's your fault, really.
Kessie, I'm not telling anything.
What?
You do not have to victim blame.
No, I mean the plays are your fault. You introduced me to the idea of narrative revenge.
Oh, only as a sort of good plot line for a beginner writer to create a relatable main character with justified motives. You did not achieve that at all. That white girl was far from sympathetic.
Okay, but remember the time when you almost punched that white
lady? Oh, she had pushed me to the edge. To the point where I actually wanted to use physical force. Something I had never felt before moving to this bullshit country.
And she could have called the cops.
Yes,
right?
Certainly she was thinking of doing something like that as soon as I started raising my voice.
something I wasn't even aware of as this violence, that yelling is considered to be in this cultural wasteland where civility is used as a substitute for humanity. Not just substituted, but weaponized against all those who do not adhere to the most strict social codes of conduct, which delineates things such as how quickly you may speak, how closely you may stand to another, when and if you may laugh, when and if you may disagree, and God forbid you speak louder than a passive-aggressive whisper. There's no too many horror stories of this. This is why I do not like to talk about such things.
Oops. Sorry.
She had pushed me to the edge. If I had hit her, she would have deported me, no question.
So what did you do instead?
I closed my mouth.
Said goodbye this time. I just wish I hadn't wasted my money buying this stupid present. Hey, wait. Yo, you ain't gotta do nothing, man. Ain't like I'm still 5 years old, right? Ain't like I'm gonna be sitting up every night asking my mom, when's dad coming home, right? Yo, who needs him? Listen, he wasn't there to teach me how to shoot my first basket, but I learned, didn't I? And I got pretty damn good at it, didn't I? I went on my first date without him. I learned to drive. I learned to shave. I learned to fight without him. I had 14 great birthdays without him. He never even sent me a damn card. What the hell with him? I need him then, and I don't need him now. And you know what? I'm gonna get through college without him. I'm gonna get a great job without him. I'm gonna marry me a beautiful honey, and I'm gonna have me a whole bunch of kids. I'm gonna be a better father than he ever was. And I sure as hell don't need him for that, because ain't a damn thing he could ever teach me about how to love my kids. How come he don't want me, man?
Excuse me, I am not waiting in that line for another 2 hours. I demand to speak to your supervisor. Oh. You're the supervisor. Well, can I say that this whole thing is not being handled correctly? You're rude. You treat people like cattle. You don't know what circumstances brought each of us here today. We've waited all day to get to this point. We just want to sit in a room and talk to somebody. Anybody! I mean, isn't there anyone in all this miserable bureaucracy who isn't merely concerned with what time to take their lunch? We need help! We are entitled to this benefit. We have all humbled ourselves just by being here, and you're behaving like some centurion guarding the gates to Rome. I mean, who gave you the right to condescend? Give me the motherfucking form! I'm not leaving without the form! Give us the form! We want the form! Come on, people! Give us the form! We want the form!
And I am medically removed from the building, which means the paramedics arrive, strap me to a gurney, administer a mild sedative, and rush me to the nearest psychiatric facility, where I spend half an hour speaking to a gentle intern who incidentally went to college with my assistant, Steffi, and I'm subsequently released with a powerful antipsychotic, which I can't use because I'm pregnant. And after all that, I still must go back to that office to fill out form 7001. And after weeks of agony, and bureaucratic hell, I was finally able to see a doctor.
Anyways, I told Jackie I would be accompanying him here today so he doesn't try to pull the wool over your eyes.
Well, glad to have you. How's the empanada?
Fucking delicious. Jackie, why don't you tell Julio here about your present predicament?
I need you to hide this gun from me, man.
Start at the beginning, Jackie.
I don't think I want to hear
this. Wait, Julio! Events transpired!
Be specific!
Okay, there was a small incident.
From the beginning, Jackie.
Alright, a couple months ago, back when I first got out, Ralph and I here had a fight.
A disagreement.
We had a disagreement, and he fired me as his sponsee.
You fired yourself.
Okay, for the sake of fucking brevity, I fired myself. And then I needed a new sponsor, so I got this woman, which everyone said, don't get a girl as a sponsor for a guy, but I was in a pinch.
You were attracted to her.
She had a very strong program.
12. Strong set of C-cups, Julio. Fucking Betty Boop with a big book, believe me.
I see.
Anyway, nothing happened. But Veronica got it in her head that she hated this woman, threatened to, quote, rip the bitch's vagina from out her fucking mouth. So obviously I had to lie and say that we weren't working together no more. And the lying led to doing things on the DL. And the DL led to feeling like there was something going on. And feeling like there was something going on, it led
you
to...
You fucked her.
I didn't fuck her. She fucked me.
Yeah, you know how that goes, Julio. Women overpower men by sheer physical force and pin them down and ride them like ponies all the fucking time. It's in the papers every day.
Whatever, something fucking minuscule happened, and I immediately ended it, and I apologized to Ralph, who took me back, but then this crazy AA girl started calling the house, and even though she never said nothing like we fucked, like on tape, Veronica got it in her head that we had, even though for all she knew we hadn't.
But you did.
Okay, but she didn't know that, and really it was more like a dream. And not like a dream that I like aspire to, huh? But like a fucking nightmare, where you wake up and you're all fucked up, and you're just like, did that just fucking happen? You know, but unfortunately, in this particular completely unintended instance...
It did.
Technically, yeah.
You fucked her.
That's my cross, alright? But in reality, Julio, in the fucking dimension outside of temporary insanity, in my heart, you gotta believe me, that shit never happened.
Okay. So, except for the fact that it actually happened, it didn't really happen.
Exactly.
Good to see we're all on the same page here.
Yeah, man, I get it. I do. It happened to me once with a guy named Frank. It was way before I got married to Marissa, and I'll tell you.
We don't need to hear about that right now! Anyway, because of this crazy AA girl, which look, I had a part in it, I'm not trying to make it like I'm a saint, even though I'm straight up more or less not guilty, but the point is this. You know that motherfucker with the hat who lives downstairs from me, huh?
A man with a hat.
Oh, you know him! You've seen him! Yeah, he's all like fake dapper, and his pants got creases and shit, and he's always wearing a brand new white t-shirt that he throws out after one fucking day. Do you know that? He's thinking he's a GQ motherfucker. Oh, and he's always sporting a brim to cover his big fucking head.
I don't know.
Anyway,
Veronica, I think, was upset about the AA woman, and so my belief is that she started fucking the motherfucker with the hat so she could prove to herself that she don't love me. But of course we all know that she do love me. And now I found out about it because that motherfucker left his hat on my table. So I got upset, I got a gun from Chuchi, I took the gun and the hat to the motherfucker with the hat apartment downstairs, and that's when a small incident happened.
You didn't shoot him, did you?
No, see, that's what Veronica would have done. She would have knocked on the door, said capping bodies and shit. But that ain't me, Julio. You know me since Chinese handball, is that me?
It's not him, it's really not.
All I did, I knocked on the door. Motherfucker with the hat answered. I didn't say nothing, I just took the hat from my house, and I tossed it on the carpet. I stared him straight in the eye, I cocked the gun, and I shot the hat on the carpet, that's all.
You opened fire in his residence?
I shot the hat on the carpet, that's all. Hey, believe me, I think that motherfucker knew what that was about, but the problem was that the bullet, it went through the hat and then ricocheted off the walls and then blew out his big screen TV and then put a hole in the guy next door's apartment, who was home at the time, so I could, like, flee. And now I gotta return the gun to fucking Chuchi, but he ain't around, so could you please hide the gun from me, man, until, like, Chuchi could be located, please?
You borrowed a gun from Chuchi.
I know.
You borrowed a gun. Chuchi!
I wasn't thinking right!
Chuchi, you borrowed a gun from Chuchi Alvarado. You did bad things with it, and now you want me to hide a gun of Chuchi Alvarado.
I'll understand if you say no.
Can I be honest with you?
Come on, man, please!
No, Jackie. It's okay, I'll hide the gun.
Oh, thank you.
All I want to say to you is that I'm happy to help because you're my cousin, you're my blood, but really, I'm doing it more for your mother's memory than for you, and I'd like to tell you why.
Okay, whatever.
Julio, would you like some privacy for this? I could wait in the kitchen or outside on the stoop.
I know. Thanks, though. And if you ever need some massage or some waxing, I'll give you my card.
Thanks.
Roughing is my specialty and Brazilian.
Cool.
I'm also a notary public.
I'm in nutritional beverages. I'll give you my card.
Great. Give me some more to pass out. I'm all about networking.
Me too.
Oh, bless you.
Yo! Y'all got any more cards you need passing out? Or can you tell me what you want to tell me, Julio, so I can be on my way?
Oh, sorry. I didn't know you were in a rush. You get what you want and leave.
I'm not.
Yeah. You are. And that's okay. The reason why I said I'm doing this more for your mother's memory than for you is because maybe I never said this before, but I don't like you very much. And the reason why I don't like you very much is because you think you're a nice guy, but really, Jackie, you're not that nice. You basically made fun of me my whole life. You talk a lot of shit. You fuck people over, not all the time, but sometimes. And really, Jackie, the space between who you think you are and who you actually are is an embarrassingly wide gap. I really hope this AA thing works out for you. I really do, because the cousin I loved and hung out with and played booties up with when I was 8 bears no resemblance to this little shit I'm looking at right now. When I first come to the States, you had my back, and really, you were a hero to me, and now hero is zero. My Marisol was right about you. It's always all about Jackie. We've been married for 3 years now, and whenever you come by our home, you don't even bring so much as a bag of pistachio. And yet you see nothing wrong with jeopardizing my relationship, my apartment, our home, by bringing criminal thing like that shit into our house. You're not a good friend. You're not a good relative. My relationship to you is that of a memory that ceased to be any kind of reality years ago. When my result caught it. You're a user. And that's okay. That's all I have to say on that. So now you can get out of my apartment and go do all those very more important things than spending time with your cousin Julio. Okay?
Yo, Julio.
Nana, go. Leave the gun. Take the empanada.
Sometimes the poor here.
But you'll have this place to call home. Darkness of the mind, this love will keep us through blinding of the eyes, silence of the ears, darkness of the mind, this love will keep us through blinding of the eyes, silence of the ears, darkness of the mind, this love will keep us through blinding of the eyes, silence of the ears, darkness of the mind.
I'm in Nanaimo, BC, on Vancouver Island right now, so I'm very far away from everyone, and I really wish that I was there. The inspiration for this story, I guess I started like thinking of a lot of these ideas like last summer, and you know, there's massive protests going on about racial justice, and like also, I guess, partly inspired by the experience of getting rent evicted and like starting to think about like the various kinds of like positions involved in these processes of gentrification and like how I'm implicated in multiple parts of them. And then kind of just like connecting, I guess, those sort of like material things with also these things that happen to do with like stories and storytelling and cultural appropriation and this kind of thing. So yeah, I guess it was like a lot of like brewing around different ideas and then having the chance to write something new and kind of like try to put those things together in a way that hopefully
you did it with us.
Thank you so much.
Sure.
All right. Thank you.
Beautiful work. What are you asking the question?
The next question is about the music. Somebody wanted to know how the music was devised and who devised it. So I'll give that to you, Chadia.
Hello. So the music, the song that I sang, Godspeed by Frank Ocean, what I decided to do was to kind of make it into my own rendition and how I would, what I feel like my sound is. So I got to work with two amazing producers, Jamal and Thane, and we worked together on kind of composing this beautiful song. And Mike Payette, the director, liked the sound of the song, so he decided to incorporate that as interludes for the play. To connect everybody together.
The yeah. Other part of that question was also if you and Joy had worked together on that, or if you were two individual working on your own. So
I would have loved to work with Joy, but we did not get the chance to. But Joy and Espoir did actually help me with like figuring out how to like keys and starting the song. So they did help me.
So it was collaborative
yeah,
in some way.
It was, yeah.
And Joy, you had done yours. Hi, Joy.
I sang the song at the beginning. It was very separate. My song is from Ragtime the Musical. It's a song that I've been working on for a few years, and it meant a lot to me. And I'm repeating myself, but yeah, yesterday I talked about how the first time I heard this song, it really stuck with me, and I wanted a song to perform in this showcase that had a lasting impact. And it was the right song. So, yeah.
Well, thank you to you both for your talents. Can I just ask you another question? So I'm just gonna ask this one last question because I would like everyone to answer it. It was a question given to us. I forget by who. But the question is what is your best amp moment?
Yeah, some of your favorite amp moments. Throughout the whole 7 months.
Yeah. So who would like to start? Because I can start naming names, but anybody want to jump in? No? Sure. Okay, Dre, go ahead, Dre, then Johnny.
I guess my favorite amp moment, by the way, hi, I'm over here, everyone. My favorite amp moment was when we all decided to discuss what our dreams were in this industry and how we all expressed ourselves with such a passion and how we can see our goals so well, like we can touch them. Like, it was amazing to see everyone's vision. And I felt great sharing mine with everyone too.
Good
so.
Answer. Johnny?
Johnny? Hello. I am Johnny. My favorite app moment. Not like as deep because there were so many, but it was the first time seeing everyone in person because I was like, oh, they're not holograms. They're real. This is great. And then getting to work together in person amidst a pandemic, like for me, just that.
Right on. Anaïs?
Hi, Anaïs. Again, like, not as deep, like, it's kind of hard to go after, you know, beautiful answer of Dre. So I'd say, like, just my favorite moment are before we start practicing, where we're just hanging out and chilling and talking. Those are all my favorite moments, like getting to know other people and just talking about anime and movies and books that we loved and silly things. Those moments I really cherished a lot, and I'm gonna miss them, and I wish we could have done all of that without masks. I wish, like, my favorite moment would have probably been like things that we would have done if we didn't have to go through this pandemic, like going out together, eating dinner, having a cookout, like all those things. Those are all gonna be my favorite moments in the future, hopefully.
Charity?
Hi, Charity. My favorite moment was actually yesterday after we finished the first show, and just leaving with the energy, like I felt like I was floating. So that was my favorite moment.
Joy. Oh, Aaron, I'm getting you, Aaron. But
I just don't want mine to be taken, so I'm like.
Hi, I'm Joy. So my favorite moment has to have been during rehearsals, once we finally started rehearsing, and all of the in-between moments. It felt like as soon as we stopped, somebody started dancing, and someone else would pick up the move. I swear to God, we were always dancing. And it was just the best. It was just everyone enjoying each other's company and like living in it. It was, yeah, good stuff. Aaron?
Yes, okay. my name is Arun. So this is a little bit cheating. It's like a series of moments. Basically, this process of putting on the showcase, and especially like the runs, like I've seen this show like, I don't know, like 10 or more times, like including the stumble through and stuff. But for some reason, I'm riveted like every time. Like when I'm off stage, I'm watching these people and it's so cool because no, it's never quite the same, you know? And like I've been in other shows where it's like, ah, okay, all right. And they're like, you know, just like tune out until, but I can't for this show, it's so great. So that's been honestly one of my favorites, yeah.
That's amazing. You said you had more than one. Did you have something else you
no,
wanted to
I'm
share?
No, I'm taking all of the showcase rehearsals. That's my moment.
That's Esquire?
Yes, my favorite moment.
I'll show your arms just in case.
I am Esquire. My favorite moment, I've been thinking so hard while they were speaking, but I can't really think of one, but it, okay. We have this group chat, and the group chat is honestly, but it's true, it's what Anaïs was touching on, it's like what Joy was touching on, all the moments in between, because we didn't get to like wait in the microwave line or like go, you know, we didn't get to have sleepovers, we didn't get to do all that stuff, so like to have this group chat to wake up and realize that like somebody and somebody's been having a private conversation that should have been a private message. That stuff is so funny. Like, that's just like, they're so comfortable around each other. each other know each other, and like to have established this level of comfort and openness, like
so like the community, like the friendship.
Yeah. My favorite moment.
Nice.
Chadia?
Hello. My favorite moment was when I think it was our first rehearsal where we got to see everyone's monologue and song and all of the work that everybody did, and that was really my favorite. That was just so extraordinary to me to kind of just see these are my peers and these are people that I'm going to be working with, and this is the atmosphere I'm going to be around. And I just, you could just tell by the amount of work ethic that each of them have put into their work, and I just respect that so much. And that rehearsal, I was just so blown away by everyone's like just talent and hard work. And yeah, everybody's just so good at what they do.
Mr. Zooey.
Hi, I'm Zooey. It's difficult to pick a favorite moment. Every single minute is my favorite moment. I don't know, I guess it's count as app, but yesterday, my grandparents, who's living in Vietnam, watched the show, and the first time ever that they get to watch me on stage.
Oh,
I
nice.
Haven't met them for years, and they didn't speak English. They have no idea what's going on. But they've sent me a message, and they're saying that they're so proud of me, even though they didn't understand anything. And it's just, you know, just having this chance to show the people that I love, to show people that miles away what I do, it means a lot. So thank you, Anne.
Oh, I'm so happy for you. That's amazing. Well, Warona and I, Esi, what is yours? How are you?
Oh, I didn't get to have any of the in-person moments. So my favorite moment, I think, is like, yeah, also kind of a series, but there would be some like of our weekly meetings where we would just like kind of check in about how everyone's feeling about like different things in life and in like the industry and like trying to work and all of these things. And like, those would be times where I'd feel so connected to everybody. And I feel like so many of the things we're all like grappling with were so connected. And that, yeah, just like throughout the whole year gave me so much like support. And yeah, okay, thank you.
Well, we're very proud of you. Thank you, everyone who, sorry, it's weird, I know, because you all can't see me, but thank you. Thank you for watching the show tonight, today, and thank you to all of our participants.